Welcome everybody to our general membership meeting. Thank you. Before I get too far along, we have 50-50 tickets that are being sold at the table where Randy is sitting. Randy's going to be there. And that's where your 50-50 tickets can be purchased. Gentlemen, we really would like to start.
Meeting is starting.
Thank you. David, would you mind preliminarily introducing our guest tonight?
Thank you. Good morning, guys. Nice turnout today. Welcome to the Lions Day. I'm going to simply introduce Mo Funk, COO of the complex, and Fred Bauer, the Centennial Dam. Mo, thank you very much for having us.
Thank you, Mo. And Mo will be presenting later on his wonderful facilities here. Do we have any new members?
New member.
Okay. Would you mind standing up and introducing yourself? We have two. Oh, hold on 1 second. Before you do that, we need the mic.
Give me a microphone.
What do I have, a half hour?
Oh!
Hello! Is it working? I can't hear. Okay, my name is Art Freiman. I was a former member of Brith Shalom until they found out about me and they threw me out. I'm a member of the JCC. What else can I tell you? That's enough? Okay. Thank you. Nice meeting you all.
My name is David Lombersky, also an ex-member of Brith Shalom of 50-some years. I live at Holiday Village in Mount Laurel, and my friend Carmen introduced me to this place, and I see a few of my friends and members, and very happy to be here. Thank you.
Welcome to both of you. And to our new members, we put you right to work. So before you sit down, I'm going to ask you to stand up again and you to lead us in Hamotzi. And we will join in. Gentlemen, if you'll lead us in Hamotzi, and we'll all join in. Baruch atu Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam Hamotzi Lechem Min Ha'aretz. And the food is to your right, coffee's to your left. We're going to go right to our finance report. There's. Finance report, Ed.
Well, as you probably all know, we had a very successful breakfast a few weeks ago, I guess a month ago. And we had the law enforcement, which I don't know whether we've talked about yet, but our law enforcement breakfast was very successful also. We collected $610 at the 50-50, which We will donate to Hero Scholarship and the Goodwin Holocaust Museum, and possibly some of the proceeds also from the law enforcement breakfast, so that the minimum that will be donated will be the $610 and probably maybe up to about $1,000. So it would be $500 to each charity, which will be very nice. Yom HaShoah, we had also a successful Yom HaShoah evening. I know the attendance was probably the largest that they've ever had, and it seems like they're outgrowing that room that they do it in. The reason I bring it up is typically some of our members have sponsored the cost of the candles for Yom HaShoah, and we have a number of people who've already sent in checks. I think you've all gotten an email from me that asked if you would like to contribute. We've collected almost the full cost of the candles that were given out that evening. If anybody's here today and wants to contribute, we want to finish up with that. We've had people contribute up to the full cost of a box of candles, which is $72. We asked if anyone wanted to contribute $9, $18, $36, $72. Your choice. If you feel that you'd like to contribute, come over to me. Make your check out. If it's a check, make it out to JCRC. 9, 18, 36, or 72 would be great. Other than that, I think that's pretty much it. Tax deductible if it's made out to JCRC, so that's why we're asking that you do it that way. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. Dick, on membership.
Okay, this is going to be real short. First of all, does everybody have their logo T-shirt? Anyone not have it? We have a few left. Mort, you never got one. We'll get you a shirt. Anyone else?
I need one.
Who said that? You need one? Yeah, I can see that. I also have application forms. So if you know of anyone who's interested in joining, we have a couple of potential members, and I think they've been introduced already, Don, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
And welcome.
And for those of you that have not yet filled out your survey form, which is about almost half of the membership, I have plenty of survey forms. Only take you a minute or two to fill it out, and then we put you to work, which is one of the best features of our organization, as you know. And name tags, if anybody needs a name tag, lost your name tag, or didn't have one here.
New members,
obviously we'll get name tags at some point. And I guess did I leave anything out?
That's included in there too, the shirt.
The shirt is included, the name tag's included. The $7 breakfast is not, but you know how great those are. And we're always looking for volunteers. You know, the board works their you-know-what off. And any way that you can help, whether it's cleanup, whether it's a program, we've had some recommendations for that. We'd love to have you join us.
One of the things that we were able to accomplish, we had the 25th anniversary celebration, and we received some very special proclamations of recognition. And Rich and Bob, I'm going to ask the dynamic duo to come up and...
For those who were not at the 25th anniversary breakfast, we, from the state of New Jersey, we got a certificate of recognition. Rather than read it, it comes from the joint legislation. It's a joint legislative resolution signed by Stephen Sweeney. And procured by Senator Beach for us. So
maybe you could lead that by the name tag.
Yeah.
We also, from the county of Camden, New Jersey, a proclamation from the freeholders. This one I will read because it's pretty neat. Whereas it is the desire of the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Camden to recognize the milestone anniversaries of exceptional community organizations, and whereas 25 years ago, the South Jersey Men's Club, number 503, where a member of the Federation of the International Federation of Jewish Men's Club was founded, since its inception, the club has been a pillar of service in Camden County and throughout South Jersey. And whereas this organization is a great supporter of the Jewish Federation, Jewish Community Relations Council, Jewish Community Center, Jewish Community Foundation, Federation Housing, Lionsgate, Jewish Family and Children's Service, and the Jewish Athletic Group, it also has been devoted to aiding local homeless shelters, the United States military, and support groups such as the Yellow Ribbon. The organization's involvement in the community at large is tremendous. And whereas the esteemed recipient of more Federation of Jewish Men's Club Torch Awards for excellence than any other men's club in the state of New Jersey, the South Jersey Men's Club strives tirelessly to continue fulfilling the legacy of distinction and service it has established in the South Jersey area. Now, therefore, the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Camden does hereby celebrate the South Jersey Men's Club 25th anniversary and does urge the citizens of the County of Camden to applaud this outstanding civic organization. Guys, we got something to be very proud of.
And one of the things the board is working on is to try to find us a permanent home so that when we receive plaques and recognition of that nature, we have a prominent place to display it and be proud of it. So that's something the board is currently working on. We're also going to show at the next meeting, right, Dave, the video, the brief video that we made. It's very worthwhile. If you were there, it was a great presentation, and if you didn't, I know you'll enjoy that. It's like a 5-minute video. Marty was one of the people involved as our nominating committee for officers for upcoming year, and he's going to give you his report.
Good morning. Okay, we have a slate of potential candidates, and I'll just go through each one and the nominating committee's recommendation, starting with president-elect, and that's Ed Silver. Where are you, Ed? Vice President of External Affairs, Dave Schwartz. Vice President of Operations, Rich Moskowitz. Currently, Vice President of Athletics, that position is still open. Vice President of Membership, Dick Knopf. Vice President of Finance, Ed Stein. Vice President of Religious Affairs, the position is open still. Vice President of Communications is Randy Acorsi. Recording Secretary is Dave Nidoff. And we have three positions, we'll call them trainees for the board, okay? Barry Adler, Dennis Satinoff, and Bob Glassman, who couldn't make today's meeting. So hopefully when we vote, you'll accept the slate.
Which we're doing right now.
Who's the president?
Currently me, I'll be finishing out one more year and helping Ed transition with Ed so that he could take over for June of next year. Now, in order to keep the things moving, I'm going to open it up if there's anybody that wants to nominate anybody for any of the positions from the floor. If not, I'm going to close the nominations because we do have transition for the new officers for June and they take office officially on July 1st. Are there any nominations for any positions from the floor? Okay, nominations are closed. I would think it's safe to say by acclamation we don't need a vote. So congratulations to those current and future officers. We appreciate everybody's hard work. And in light of that, I want to mention one of the things the board is looking at is we're breaking down every office, every vice president's office, into what tasks are involved. And our strength is only that we have other people helping and contributing. So we're trying to break it down into the smallest detail, and then I'll be presenting that at a future meeting, whether it be next meeting or the one after that. And I'm going to really ask for you people to volunteer to take one of those things so that it makes it that much easier for those that are taking the role as officers to get what they have to get accomplished, you know, done in a successful manner. So that's something you'll look forward to. I've already received quite a bit of feedback on that process, and we're continuing with that effort. Nelson?
Thank you, Don. Okay, some of you probably were delayed in coming here because in front of Cherry Hill East High School, there was the Lance Corporal Jeremy Kane run today. It's a 5K run. For those of you who don't know who Jeremy Kane was, he's a Jewish Marine that was killed in Afghanistan. I believe it was in 2012, but I'm not sure. It could have been 2010. Okay, when I was standing there listening to the speeches, obviously I was in the run, but I couldn't run because I hurt myself playing basketball. That's my excuse, my ankle. I was standing there, I was thinking about all the Jews that have been killed in the military since 9/11. And the Jewish War Veterans says there's approximately 55 that we know about. They're Jewish. Okay, I think the number's closer to 75 because we only put the names on our list when the parents or the spouse allows us to do that. And I was thinking about us, the South Jersey Men's Club. Throughout many years, more than since 9/11, must be 25 years, we've been supporting the military. I remember back in the Gulf Wars, Gulf War I, Gulf War II, etc., we sent foods, gifts, everything over to the military. That's one of the reasons I'm still a member here, and I think you are still a member, because we do the social stuff, the stuff that really makes a difference, not only for the military, but for everybody else. Thank you, Don, for letting me speak, and I just want to end saying I'm proud to be a member of the South Jersey Men's Club, and I think you are too.
And we're very proud to have Nelson as a long-term member. David, can you give us an update on JFCS? And the activities that they're doing that we should just get a reminder on?
I'd like to let you know, first of all, that I've officially signed up for Take the Wheel, the program at the Jewish Family Services organization that is set up to assist veterans who need to get to doctor's appointments, go to the VA, et cetera. I have to tell you, I'm really very impressed with the Jewish Family Services. I was unaware that they've been around for many, many years, I think 80, 90 years. There's an endless need for people like ourselves to volunteer. I have volunteered. If I can pass the background, the police background check, anyone can in this room. So I think it's $29 that they will pay for to have that done, but then they ask you to absorb that if you like. In any event, I'm signed up. I did have one assignment already, a delightful hour or two spent. I think it's important to tell you that we need to get more people, if we can, from our group to volunteer. There's not a real big commitment, just a commitment. By that I mean it's not like they're going to call you every week and ask you to drive someone somewhere. They ask you if you're available. If you are, great. If you're not, fine. But it can be something, I'm led to believe, as little as one assignment a month. And it can be a very short distance, as mine was last week, or maybe over to, I think, Fort Dix or Washington Township, maybe the city. So give it some thought. If you want any more information, I'll be happy to provide it to you. Ed?
David, how do we sign up if we're interested? What's the next step?
How do you sign up?
Yeah.
Simply either call me or call Jewish Family Services. They send out an application, or you can pick it up at the JCC, give it to them, and they'll do the background check. Thank you.
I just want to go back to something I missed. I wanted to thank the nominating committee, Jerry Metzner, Barry Rosenberg, Marty Raffner, and Barry Adler, for taking the time to put together our slate. We appreciate it, guys. Jewish Athletic Group. Dave asked me not to call on him on this, so I'm not going to call on him, but I will ask him if there's anything on ABC that you need anybody to know. ABC events?
Basically, I'm the representative for the JCC's contact with men's clubs. And the two big things they've asked me to try and get men's club membership to participate in are the Arts, Books, and Cultural Festival, which is every November, and the Jewish Film Festival, which is every April. At the present moment, obviously, there's nothing hot happening. But hopefully we're going to have a meeting of all men's club presidents throughout the South Jersey area, Bethel, Beth Tikva, whatever. And we're going to try and see if we can get all of the men's clubs working together, not coming up with programs that tread on each other's toes, that if possible have some joint activities, plus have all the membership fully aware of the various programs that JCC puts out. So basically, at the present moment, I have nothing to add but to say that hopefully this meeting with all the presidents comes up sometime, either right at the beginning or at the end of summer, and that hopefully we'll have a lot of people showing up at the Arts, Books, and Cultural Festival. There is usually one evening that's set aside for men. It's like a men's movie or something like that, like we had Touchdown Israel, or there's a speaker at the Arts, Books, and Cultural Festival. Like last year, we had a guy that was involved with St. Andrew's Golf Course. So that we will always try and have something, and hopefully you guys will participate when those things come up.
Our softball team is currently playing. I don't know how they're doing. All I know is going into today's action, I believe they were in the second place, so we hope that they do well today. After this meeting, I'm going to hold a brief orientation. If any of you are interested in fantasy football, we already have our draft set up. We already have 8 teams, and we'll be adding teams. If you're interested, want to hear a little bit more about it, right after the meeting here, we'll grab a corner and spend 10 minutes or so and answer any questions that you might have. If you're interested in attending the MAR convention, the national convention, that's in Miami Beach, July 8th through 12th, please let us know. There is a subsidy that is provided through MAR, but most of the cost is still borne by you. Ed, would you mind coming up? Ed is our sort of JCRC. He'll fill you in on what the status of JCRC is and another idea that he had.
Also, just as a reminder, we have a book exchange, and after the meeting, you're invited to come over and select a book or two or more. And usually we donate the balance of the books to the Federation building. However, the balance will be donated to the Lions Gate. So help yourself. We also have the toiletry articles, and David, I guess you'll take them to the shelter, right? Okay, great.
And eyeglasses.
And eyeglasses also, thank you. Also, the telephones that we donate, usually Larry Lessinger takes care of them, but I understand he's a little under the weather. Does anyone know how to take them to? You can take care of that too? Great. All right. In terms of the JCRC, the Jewish Community Relations Council, I have been representing the men's club at the board meetings of the JCRC. And they recently got rid of that community organization board member membership. So I've agreed to maintain my relationship with them for the 2 years, but I'm no longer representing the men's club. Dr. Berman also is involved on the board, and I guess if there's anything significant, we can report it anyway. Okay, thanks, Lynn. Sir?
In Hershel, what we do once every 3 or 4 months, we talk to the owner of Short Hills Deli on a Monday, all day, whatever people come in, 10% of the money raised is given to the food bank at JCC. I think that's a good thing for your members to think about.
Actually, we do that now. There's some food over there now that we give to the Jewish Family Service. And then we usually do it every time we're meeting at the JCC. But today, there's a few things, I guess some of us will take it over there. But we already do that now, but thanks for the idea. And yes, we're all welcome to, invited to bring food to donate to the Jewish Family Service. Lastly, we came up with an idea, but we don't know where to go with this, so let me just throw this out on the table. As you know, a large part of what we've done has been really led by Mike Perloff in terms of the Law Breakfast, Mideast, and, say again?
He doesn't do
the Mideast. Okay, Law Breakfast, and he does a lot of things for us. He's actually probably the real reason that the Men's Club maintained its existence after it left the synagogues that it belonged to. And the idea was that perhaps it would be a good idea to have some kind of an event honoring him.
We've already done it. 10 years, 15 years
too
late.
So
it's time to do it again.
I'm guessing there's some resistance to the idea, but if there is any thought,
it wasn't a new idea.
We're resurrecting an old idea, but I don't know whether it's something that you guys would want to do, how to organize it, whether it ought to be a surprise, whether it be something he would know about. So I'm just thinking out loud, and I love your input. So any ideas? Other than Bob's...
I was just going to say, other than Bob's input.
Well, if you know, as you know, what I do for a living is mental health, and the belief is in a group, one person speaks for the group. So perhaps there is some resistance to the idea of doing anything.
Bob, you can't speak yet. So I think it's a great idea, even if we did honor him, and I agree we did 15 years ago. But that was a transition. He didn't want to be president anymore, so we had to get him out of that job somehow by saying, there's a testimony for him. It's time to do it again. And he does do quite a bit for us, behind the scenes mostly.
You know, what's your thought about doing something? All who like the idea, we're not sure what to do or how to do it, but all who like the idea.
If it's a surprise to let him watch the video.
Right. All opposed to the idea. So I guess the next question would be, what to do, how to do it. And I don't know. Bob.
I think just a simple, dedicated breakfast to him.
Just
dedicated
breakfast
meeting.
Uh-huh.
We could roast them.
Ooh, a roast.
We could definitely roast them. That's just not surprise.
I like the idea of a roast. What's your thought about?
Roast them?
Yeah. That means everybody would have to, whoever wants to participate would have to put together a little 2 or 3 minute blurb to roast them.
Yeah. We can make this a fundraiser. Okay.
Oh, he would do it. Everybody put that here.
How about, could we get a committee going that could meet privately?
Yeah, that's
okay. Okay, I'll do it. David, Rich, okay, Nelson, Len. All right. I'll call all of you. We'll see if there's a day and time we can get together. Okay, thank you very much.
And before we get to our speaker, just one other thing, Marty, you want to talk about the Israel trip at all?
Okay, I'm sure most of you know that five families are going to Israel on October 13th through the 26th. It's still open. If anybody's interested in going, just let me know and we can make arrangements. You know, we started this thing, I guess, back in November or December. We're 4.5 months away. That's how fast time flies. The group has been meeting every other month, I guess. We go out for dinner together. So we're building up camaraderie even before we get there. And we're looking forward to this trip. But again, if anybody is interested, let me know.
And thanks, Marty, for all your hard work in putting that together. I'm sure it'll be a great trip. David, would you like to please come up and introduce our guest and host?
Once again, I'd like to thank Mo Funk for inviting us here. I thought it was a fabulous breakfast. If there's any white fish left over, I can take it home. In any event, Mo, thank you for having us. Please take a few minutes and tell us about your organization. Thank you.
I'm a roamer, so I'm not going to... Never hear me right?
Sure.
Yeah, I hear.
Roamer means gypsy, right? Roamer means gypsy.
Well... Yeah, probably right. Anyway, I'm Mo Funk. I am the CEO of what is the umbrella organization called Jewish Senior Housing Healthcare services, which encompasses Lionsgate, as well as our three affordable housing, buildings, Dubin and Gesher, which are on the west side of Cherry Hill, and also Saltzman House, which is behind the Jewish Community Center and Federation Complex on Springdale Road. So I have the responsibility of all of that. And to give you a sense of size of the organization and scope, if you want to just compare ourselves to the total of all of the agencies within the Federation, we are larger than the sum total of all of them, okay? From both an employee base as well as a revenue base, okay? And also obviously assets, because we have physical assets like Lionsgate, which is considerable, as well as the three affordable housing buildings. So we have a pretty large operation. I think you also would be surprised to know, because I mentioned this to David and he was surprised, and so maybe the rest of you are as well, we receive zero funding from the Federation. Zero. Zero. So if anyone has the notion that we get allocations or whatever, we get nothing. We are self-sustaining, both in our housing operations as well as with Lionsgate. Okay, so we don't receive any allocations at all from the Federation. In fact, we probably have... I don't know, maybe about $10 or $15 million more revenue on an annual basis than they do in total. Lionsgate, the building that you're in, is, let me go back. Let me just tell you a little bit about me. I've been here about 2 years and 3 months or so, something like that. I got a call when I was in Florida, and I have been in Florida since the early 80s, in the senior living or healthcare environment in one way or another. Either operating freestanding facilities, nursing homes, independent living, assisted living. I own my own physician network that just provided physician services in a skilled nursing environment. And I've had a sort of a broad experience both on the not-for-profit as well as the for-profit side of geriatric or senior healthcare. And I was sitting at my desk, and at the time I was working for Miami Jewish Health Systems. And to give you a difference of the size of the organization, that's a $140 million organization versus Lionsgate, which is, you know, 60 plus. Okay, so the scope and size of where I was compared to here is significantly different. But I was sitting at my desk one day, and I got a call from someone that says, hey, you have any interest in the CEO role in Voorhees, New Jersey? And you know, I'm from Chicago, okay, and I've been in Florida, but Jersey was like foreign territory to me. So the first thing I said is, where the hell is Voorhees, New Jersey? And there was a long pause on the phone by the guy who was calling me. It was the board, the representative of the board here was in charge of the search committee. And so a long pause on the phone, and he says, well, do you remember where Cherry Hill, do you know where Cherry Hill is? And I said, I only know Cherry Hill because my sister was married to someone who originally was from Jersey, and they went to some mall there. And another long pause on the phone. He's really not doing a great job of trying to at least get my initial interest, right? And then he says, we're 9 miles across the bridge from Philadelphia. You know where Philadelphia is? I said, yes, I know where Philadelphia is. So I said, all right, we'll have to call you back because I got to float that geography balloon at home. Now, I'm married to a native Floridian, okay, who winter was not a season that she recognizes. We floated the balloon at home, and it kind of worked out okay. Her brother, who's a physician, is in Bethesda, short drive to Bethesda, quick drive up to the mountains, quick to New York, quick to the beach. So she says, all right, go ahead, you can take a look and see if that works out. She was very surprised that it actually worked out, and she ended up having to move with me to Voorhees, New Jersey. But we're happy to be here, and we have one son who is a... he's transitioning into his senior year at the University of Michigan. He's an industrial operations engineering student, and he's doing well. He's got a great internship this summer at American Express, not far from where he grew up in Florida and Plantation. So, so all's good on the home front and everything here. Lionsgate has been progressing nicely, I think, since I've been here. We've made a lot of changes. When I first got here, we opened up, and to kind of give you the different levels of care that we have here. We have independent living. We have 164 independent living units, okay? 12 of them are cottages, and you've probably seen those cottages on the perimeter. The other
units or apartments in various sizes. Then we have an assisted living piece, which is also part of Lionsgate on this campus, and there's 70 units of assisted living. Within assisted living, there is a unit called Safe Haven. That is a locked, secure unit for folks who have Alzheimer's or various types of dementia, okay? And then the rest of the apartments are just the regular apartments in assisted living. And then we have 70 skilled or long-term beds where people here for nursing home care long-term. And then we added, just when I arrived, we added 32 short-term stay rehab beds, two floors, brand new building, right attached to the nursing facility and around the back of the community. You can get to all of these places under air, okay? So you don't have to walk outside in inclement weather. You can traverse as long as you got the right key fob to get from place to place. And we can people can travel, you know, within the envelope of the building to all these different care settings. We are a Type B community. And in the continuing care retirement community world, I'll tell you what that means. There's a Type A, there's a Type B, and there's a Type C. Okay, a Type B community is one where you pay an entrance fee to enter into the independent living section of the community. And there's various sizes of apartments and places and cottages, and there's various price ranges, obviously, depending upon size of those units. And to give you just a sense, you know, you're talking about the smallest apartment, you know, maybe it's like $210,000, and the largest apartment is $410,000. Okay? Right. Now, there is a 90 and a 50% refundable model on those apartments. So in other words, you will get back or your family will get back whatever the balance is, the 50% or the 90%, once you give up your place. Now, however, with a Type B community, if you have to transfer from independent to assisted, or you jump from independent to skilled because there's a reason that, or a healthcare reason why that was necessary, you go into those particular places paying for the services at whatever the pricing is at that particular time. You give up your unit. Now your unit availability, your cash gets back to you after a certain period of time if we don't sell the unit, okay, or sooner if we do. But you have to pay for those particular care settings under a Type B agreement. A Type A agreement is one where you pay for a independent living entry. You usually do not enter from an assisted living or a skilled nursing directly. You have to enter independent, but you move down the continuum, but you do not get your entrance fee back. But what that does guarantee you is that you will be here in the community throughout the continuum and at the rate that you are paying an independent living. So in other words, for example's sake, let's say you're paying $2,000 a month to live in independent living, and then you'll pay $2,000 a month no matter what care setting you're in. And that's under a Type B, but you don't get your entrance fee back, okay? Under a Type A, I'm a Type A. Under Type B, you can enter directly into skilled nursing, directly into rehab, and directly into assisted living. You don't have to enter into independent living. Okay, but if you do, you do pay an entrance fee. Okay, a Type C is sort of just a full rental. You can rent wherever you are, whatever that rate is. Okay, but there's no guarantees other than you pay that rental rate, and you have to pay it depending upon what the cost is for each of those particular settings. And some communities today are exploring, those that have Type A or Type B like us, or just Type C, are exploring opportunities to do hybrid models, meaning that we will offer some A, some B, some C, and we'll eventually get around to looking at that ourselves. But that's how we are structured from an entrance standpoint. Now we have the three levels of care. Independent, people are here, they drive, they can come and go, there's a meal plan, there's social and activities that we put on here at Lionsgate. We have transportation services to local events and to doctor's appointments and those kind of things. Assisted living, to qualify for assisted living, you have to have the need for some assistance, medication management, help with some activities of daily living, helping you get up, get dressed, get going. There is a central dining room where all residents eat in assisted living, though. Then there's the nursing facility, which is obviously full care. okay? And then rehab is that short-term stay rehab where someone comes in post a knee replacement or fractured hip or has a decline in function of some kind and they're there for a short period of time, usually under a Medicare reimbursed stay because you qualify for the need for quote-unquote skilled care for a period of time. And then you end up going back to your home or wherever you reside. To give you a sense of the affinity group that we're serving, you would assume that we're serving a lot of Jews in this community, obviously because of who we are and our roots. However, in independent living, it's primarily Jewish. Okay, but there are a handful of residents who are not Jewish in independent living. Assisted living, it is a majority still that's Jewish, but much less so than independent. And as we transition to skilled and to rehab, you further go down the percentages of Jewish folks that we're serving in those settings. And you would think that that would be the case because others are using our services from the outside and not coming in from the independent side. But so we have an open access and door. And quite frankly, I think they're coming to us because of the care. The care has just been wonderful. We're getting great reviews out of the short-term stay rehab. Our outcomes are great. Our functional score gains are great. So we're really doing some neat things in there. And we constantly get good feedback from the folks who are utilizing those services. We have the other piece of the business that I'm responsible for is the affordable housing. Okay, Dubin, Gesher, and Saltzman. And what's unique about them is that there are three different types of affordable housing buildings because of the way they are structured. Gesher is a HUD PRAC 202, which is a rental assistance. So there's a sliding scale, if you will, based upon income. So there's some assistance for those folks who live in Gesher. Dubin is a Section 8 housing, which is a little bit different structure. And then Saltzman House has been an expired tax credit, but age and income qualified as well. And at Saltzman House, there are different levels of income slots. So depending upon where you are is where you are on the waiting list. And to give you a sense of the need for affordable housing in this community, we have probably about 150 names on the Dubin and Gesher list. And we probably have about 100 names on the Saltzman list, okay? Unfortunately, we can't meet everyone's need. And it's been a usual occurrence, unfortunately, that people expire before we're even able to get them into one of our buildings. As sad as that is, but just the way it is. So we are very fortunate in the sense that we have a waiting list, but we just can't meet the full need of the community on the affordable housing side. We have to kind of give you a sense of some of the things that are going to be changing here at Lionsgate moving forward. We have in July of last year, I think it was July of last year, we did a refinancing, a new bond offering. And we did a $61 million bond offering here at Lionsgate. And as a result of that $61 million bond refinancing, what we were able to accomplish were really some really important things from a business perspective. One is we were able to take $4.5 million and put that into a renovation project fund for a particular purpose that we had in mind. We also reduced our cost of our interest payments, obviously, because we had some rate decline, which was very helpful to the overall economics of managing the business. And then last, we own golf land, if you didn't know that, next door, okay? The miniature golf course or whatever, we own that. We lease it to the guy who runs it, but we own that. But what we were able to do with that particular piece of property in the refi and the bond documents was we were able to, at our choice, when we're ready, subdivide that land to do something that we want without having to go back to get bondholder approval. Okay, so it's not necessarily fully pledged against the, bond offering. So those were very significant business gets, if you will, in that bond refinancing. Now back to that $4.5 million that's sitting in this project fund, and what are we gonna do with it? We are just now finishing the design documents with the architects. But we are going to redo the front here where you're sitting, the dining room, the card room space, and we're going to build a brand new auditorium just on the other side of this dining room. Okay? Right now we're sitting in Commons Hall, but the back of Commons Hall is a dining room. So when you're having programming in the community and dining is going on and you want to have a program that's on at 7 o'clock and people are still dining, obviously there's a lot of noise and chatter, and you know what, you can't open up the room and have a big presentation if you want to. So we've done a lot of work with a architectural firm called Perkins Eastman, who is they do a ton of senior living design. I've had some opportunity to work with them in my prior lives. But we're redesigning the space here. We're going to have a larger bistro where people can come in and have casual dining. And the whole space of senior living is really changing. We're going with multiple dining venues now in spaces like this because the residents are looking for different types of places to dine. They don't want to be in a formal dining room every single night. They want a casual experience. Maybe they're running out to a play or to a concert. They don't want to waste the time to sit down and have dinner and wait for it to come. They can just go through the line at the bistro and sit down and get in and get out. So we're changing the whole scope of how this looks. We're going to add a bar. Obviously, research shows that the folks that are coming behind the ones who are here now are looking for the opportunity to socialize around a bar setting for cocktails and for receptions. So we're adding that to the space. And we're just trying to make sure that we are maintaining our competitive advantage. And the residents would say to me, they say to me often, well, why are we spending $5 million? We're only 7 or 8 years old. Well, my answer back to them is, we need to maintain the competitiveness of Lionsgate. We have been afforded the luxury of having one of the largest the strongest occupancy levels of any continuing care retirement community in the country. Okay, we're way up there in the top handful of percentages, okay, throughout the country. So in order to continue and to maintain that, we need to be competitive and make sure that we are positioning the community in order to attract people behind the folks who are aging out or leaving. So we are doing, we think, what the responsible thing is to make sure that we continue to evolve and make sure that we're doing what we need to do. We have an outsourced vendor who handles our food, and they are it was Morrison Senior Communities or Morrison Senior Living. They've rebranded on the East Coast. Now they're called Flick Dining or Flick Senior Dining. I'm not sure what the actual name is, but that's really the only outsourced, other than therapy, organization that we contract with. The rest of the staff here at Lionsgate is our own. We have an interesting argument all the time, or a spirited discussion, maybe I should say, with the residents here about food. If you can imagine, gentlemen, living or working in an environment with 85-year-old women on average who have been cooking all their lives, you'll never make the brisket like they do. You'll never make the kugel the way they like it. The corned beef is always going to be too salty, okay, or too fat, or the guy in the kitchen doesn't know how to cut a brisket. Let me go in there and help him, okay? All right. So, and there was a great article actually in the New York Times. I don't know if anyone saw it, but it was titled My Grandmother's Meatloaf. Okay, and it went on to talk about what CCRCs or retirement communities are doing to change the dining experience, putting in sushi bars and separate venues and things like that to attract the next wave of people who are coming in and make sure that that's there. Now, that's being done for the next wave. But they went on to sort of validate my comments that, well, you know, those are the individuals who are here today. You know what? There's a group that thinks raisins should be in the kugel, and there's another group that says raisins shouldn't be in the kugel. Who's right or who's wrong? I can ask two people, how'd you like dinner tonight? I hated it. Oh, I loved it. Well, who's right? Okay? It's a matter of taste. And the other piece of it that's what's difficult in the setting is, and you may recognize it with yourselves, some of you, your taste buds change as you age. Okay? That's not me just making an excuse. That's what happens. Okay, so what they're remembering and what they're tasting is not the same as, or what they're tasting is not what they're remembering. So it's a difficult food's always a difficult discussion here, but I will tell you that, at least from my perspective, it's not my first rodeo. I mean, we're really doing a great job, and Morrison's has really been a wonderful partner for us on the food service venue. So, the Lionsgate is very strong. We posted a strong first quarter, and things seem to be moving in a good direction. So. Anyway, I appreciate you all being here, and happy to answer any questions that you have.
I'm curious about your demographics and your different units, especially independent daycare. What's the age groups?
The age group, the average entrant today in a CCRC is 86 years old, and we are the same.
86?
Entrant to independent living, 86.
That's amazing.
Okay. Okay, that's a national average. Well, let me just briefly tell you why, okay? People are, one, living longer today. They're also healthier than prior generations. So really what precipitates sometimes, and unfortunately so, that move to us at that age is something happened to one or the other spouses that precipitated the need for one or other not to be able to handle the home, household duties, et cetera, dealing with all that stuff, okay? So that's how. I mean, that's the back of the envelope answer, but that's the reality of why that age entry is that high.
Is Lionsgate profit enough,
though? Lionsgate is a totally nonprofit 501c3, sorry.
And all levels of care, do you allow alcohol?
Yes, along in the healthcare settings, doctor needs to write the order. In independent living, we serve wine and beer. Obviously kosher, but yes, so it's not the best bottles of wine, although some will argue that you can get good kosher wine. I'll argue against it, but okay. Yes?
You talked also about affordable housing.
Yes.
Three complexes.
Yes.
This is kind of a rhetorical question, but I assume you feel the government maybe ought to do more in that area, and do you see your organization applying for additional funding? Is any of that available through the tax credits? Or
there's some tax credits available, but they're slim and none and hard to get. Mm-hmm. When they do come up, the problem with affordable housing is, especially on the PRAC 202, which is Gesher, the way they were set up, we can't add additional debt in order to rehab the buildings and those kind of things, which you would do just like we did here at Lionsgate. You know what, we had a bond, we decided we're gonna refinance, we'll add some more debt, maybe push it out a little bit, maybe lower the interest rate. We can't do that in some of these affordable housing buildings because of the way those were set up originally by the federal government. Now they're trying to scramble now because what they have is they have a plethora throughout the country of these aging buildings that are affordable housing, but they can't be fixed because the operators have difficulty in doing that because they can't add additional debt to the building in order to use that for rehabbing the buildings just because of the way they're structured. So it's a problem nationally that is going to have to get resolved one way or another. We're somewhat lucky in the sense that we have we're obviously mission-based, but we also have and we're starting to fundraise and trying to figure out ways to increase the benevolent fund of the organization in order to pay for some of those things and pay for people who outlive their assets, okay? Because quite frankly, it's happening. It's happening right here at Lionsgate.
You started off by stating you get no money from the Federation.
Yes.
But you clearly get governmental money because you talked about HUD, and I'm sure the social service money. So out of your total budget, what percent comes from government or maybe private charities as contrasted to income that you get directly from residents?
Maybe 20%.
20% comes from government and so forth?
Yeah.
What do you do with people who outlive their assets?
Well, here at Lionsgate, a couple things are happening. Sometimes someone may come into independent living, and so we're clear on how one comes into independent living. You don't just walk in and say, hey, I want to live here and stroke down your $300,000. We actually go through a very, very robust financial process where we take a look at your assets, your ability to pay your monthly rate, your age, and we have actuarial people much smarter than I who figure out whether or not you meet the threshold that we have set from a board standpoint of how you can come in on independent living. However, there have been cases, and there will be cases, my view, that folks will outlive their assets because, one, I think we're doing a good job of keeping people active and healthy, and they will just outlive their assets. Well, once they outlive their assets, then they can, what we've done in the past is we've been starting to erode their entrance fee. They don't get it back. Okay? Now, when that entrance fee is gone on the independent living side, then we have to kick in the benevolent fund of somehow to be able to support those individuals here. And I will tell you, that's a focus that we've had of recent, is to try to build the corpus of that benevolent fund, because my view is we have a freight train coming at us. Okay? It's just you know, I mean, it's just the way it is. I mean, people are aging, they're living longer, and if we're going to be a viable organization, we have to figure out how to be able to support that. So it's going to be a problem. It's not a problem today, but my vision down the road is I see that happening more often than it's happening now.
Do you see people being asked to leave?
There's been a commitment of the organization to not ask people to leave. Okay, whether that changes down the road, I can't tell you. I can guarantee that standing here today, but the commitment had been there previously, and we'll see where that goes. Okay? I mean, at the end of the day, I have $61 million of bonds sitting out there. I need to be able to pay for them. Plain and simple. I mean, you know, just because we're nonprofit doesn't mean no margin. Okay, I remember I used to work in Catholic healthcare. Many moons ago, and I was sitting around a board table once, and there was a Sister Jean who was sitting at the other end of the table. And if you ever had an opportunity to work with nuns, they're quite direct at times. And she's reading the financials, and she's looking at me, and I'm running the community at the time, and she bangs her fist on the table, and she points her finger at me, and she goes, "Mo, no margin, no mission. You can't have a mission. You can't have a mission unless you have a margin. Okay, we can't continue to you know, support people if we can't make enough in order to be able to do that. Okay, and that rung very true to me, and pretty much how from that point on I governed myself as it relates to trying to figure out making sure that we're a sustainable organization so the mission can continue.
What's the typical size of a residence, and is there like a monthly fee?
If you come in independent living, okay, the entrance fees are somewhere between $210,000 to $400,000, depending on the size of the apartment. You may pay anywhere from $2,500 to $3,500 a month for your monthly nut that you have to have on top of that. Okay, so you pay that monthly. Okay, when you leave independent living and you transfer to assisted, whatever the rack rate is on a daily basis for that or monthly basis for independent living or for skilled nursing, you'll be paying that. You'll no longer be paying that monthly fee. You'll be paying that. An average cost today to live in a nursing facility, ours included, is somewhere around $125,000 a year. Cash. So, and Medicare does not pay for long-term care. Now, there are some of you may have long-term care policies that may supplement or pay for that. However, unless you have a really old policy that was really good at the beginning when you bought it, okay, then you're golden. If you bought one further on down the road and decide I need long-term care, those policies aren't as rich as the older ones. But that's typically what so you'd have to make up the difference if your policy was a shortfall to pay for that long-term care here at Lionsgate.
What's RAC?
What, RAC rate? Just the hotel rate, whatever the rate is at the time. Sorry.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
$2,500.
What are you entitled? Well, you have the basic upkeep of your apartment. You have activities that you attend that are obviously not extra. If there's anything that's done, that's right. You have a meal plan. Okay. Some folks are on a 30-day meal plan. Some folks are on a 20-meal plan in independent living. In assisted and skilled, you get 3 squares a day. Okay, those are 3 meals a day. You get those in those settings because they're more of a healthcare setting. Independent living, there's you can cook in your apartments, and you have a full apartment, so you don't have to take the meal plan if you don't want to. I would say the majority of residents do. Okay, they may not use their 30 every month or their 20 every month because they go out and they have cars, they drive, they do their own thing. But yeah, totally up to them. We're eventually going to change when we redo the space here. to probably go to a declining balance where we give them dollars and then they order off the menu and there's a pre-fee number and we decline their balance and figure out how to do that versus a meal plan. That's pretty much old school, and the thought today is residents are preferring a declining balance.
If you have an individual who needs to go to a doctor or a hospital or whatever the case is that monthly rate cover transportation?
Yes, there's transportation for them. If they need a doctor's appointment, they have to make the appointment with us and we'll take them and right. I mean, there may be a cost outside of a mile radius, I think we charge them, but I don't know what it is.
You have volunteers here as well.
We have volunteers here as well, and if anybody wants to volunteer, we clearly have tons of opportunities. Not only you mentioned the friendly visitor earlier, but you can do that. We have the rabbi needs a ton of help. I mean, we have one rabbi, and you can imagine what Friday night we have. We have one, two, three, four. We got five Shabbos services. Because if you think about it, one here in independent living, one in assisted living, one in safe haven, one in skilled nursing, and one in rehab. Well, they may combine the rehab one, so maybe at least four. So the rabbi, I call them like the rabbi in roller skates. So what we're trying to do this year is we recognize that he needs some help, and we did not budget for any additional help. So what we're trying to do is we have an ask out there to our residents as well as to the people who are connected to us in order to help fund a rabbi intern for the remainder of this year. And we think we're getting close, but most likely we'll achieve the $10,000 goal that we have in order to get him some help. So you can help with services, you could help with activities. We have a whole host of opportunities. We have programming both on the IL side, independent living, and we have programming folks who deal with the skilled nursing and assisted living. So you can call me, you can call my assistant, we can hook you up with whoever if you have a particular passion or interest in something. If you are a professor or a teacher and you taught something in your past lives and you want to teach a class, you know what? We're always looking for ways to enhance the residents' experiences and tap into resources that are in the community. Any other questions?
A person who is blind, what level would he enter at the facility?
Blind?
You wouldn't be eligible for independent living.
If someone's able to be blind and live independently, then they can live independently. You know what? I mean, just because you have a walker doesn't mean you are not independent. Okay? You just need the walker or an assistive device or a cane or whatever, or braille or whatever, in order to maintain your independence. Okay? When you become dependent, obviously we'll make those decisions or we'll understand when that is. That's when we say you need to move down the continuum or at least try to make arrangements for you to do that.
Are you allowed to have a pet?
Yes. I forgot the size, but yes. I would prefer that you not have a pit bull, no. And if you have a pit bull, no.
No. I have lots of comments and observations. I won't put them out here. But what I'm concerned with is, are there any circumstances within which you would subsidize some persons to make it possible for them to use the guidance facility?
You have to be self-sustaining to move in and meet the actuarial requirements and the financial tests that we do on the way in. Yeah. On the tail end, if you exhaust your assets at that particular point in time, I mentioned we're trying to build this benevolent fund, that's when we would help, but we would not do that on the way in. And a lot of people have we get a bad name, if you will, or we're knocked, and that Lionsgate is only for the rich. Well, I don't care whether you're at Lionsgate's nursing facility or you're down the block at another facility. It's the same 100 grand, 125 grand that you're paying for care if you're paying privately, okay? So it's not that different, okay? But you do, when you do come in independent living, you can't just come in with just the entrance fee. You have to have the resources to be able to support that monthly fee for whatever the actuarial time is that we figure out.
Is the fastest, is it Safe Haven? Is that the part that's expanding the fastest?
Safe Haven is the locked dementia unit, and there is always a need for more dementia services in the community, and that will increase dramatically as time goes on. So we'll have to solve for that. We don't, you know, it's a tough one. You know, we're besides the work that we're doing in here to fix all this other stuff, you know, the golf farm is another another opportunity for us to take a look at what the needs of the community are, figure out ways that we can add additional services and support on the golf farm to sort of round out the campus, and you know, we'll have to go through the strategic planning and the development planning to see what's best, highest and best use in that regard for that land. Yes?
There was an article in the paper I saw recently about that there were two kinds of plans to divide that land.
There's a 90% and 50%.
90% and 50%.
Yeah.
They said that most people going into nursing homes or not these kind of facilities assume that it's 90% of what they paid in, whereas in a lot of places it's 90% of what they resell the unit.
No, it's what they paid in. Here, if there's an increase in pricing, you're going to get your 90% of what you paid in, not the...
talking about decrease in price when people getting back less.
No. Right now, the way our agreement is set up, as I remember it, and it's been a long time since I looked at it, but if you have if you pay $100,000 for a unit, right, you're going to get 90% of that back. You're going to get $90,000 back, okay? When we sell the unit, or the sooner of, I don't know, 2 years or whatever the time frame is, you get that back. So in other words, we have a period of running time to remarket that unit, and then we give that money back to whomever. Now, if you remain in the community, you can't have that $90,000 to pay for your health care until we sell that unit, okay?
No, what they were saying is that in places with this declining markets,
yeah,
that if they paid $100,000 for the unit, and then when the unit gets resold for $90,000, for example.
It's not our agreement currently, but that's a good idea. Thank you. I'm gonna talk to Ralph Farah, my CFO, on Monday with that.
Actually, you have two questions for you. Yes. Is there something like a 90-day try independent care or something in the facility, and then you leave without any penalty? And also, what's your percentage of people actually leaving after 1 year or less?
Very rare that people are leaving. Sometimes what's happening more often than not is people are moving back here from Florida to be closer to family members. We're seeing a lot of people who have done that over the course of the last couple of years. Rarely do they leave. What they do is they go down the continuum of care. Sometimes, you can, and I should have mentioned earlier, but you know, everyone also gets a health exam by our physicians in our clinic before they move in independent to make sure that they have the cognitive ability and the physical ability to get around. Even though they may have a walker, they still have the physical ability to be independent. So we do go through not only a medical assessment, but also a financial assessment before somebody comes in.
Did you also get a 90-day try period?
We don't do that in independent living. I will tell you that we have, you know, we have four apartments open. I mean, if somebody wants to, you know, come try, maybe if they want to stay in one of the guest suites or something, maybe we could do that, but we wouldn't put them necessarily in an apartment. No. Okay? All right.
Before you sit down, I'd like to thank Mo for a great presentation and the great courtesy of hosting us for this event. Our certificate of appreciation and a free 1 year membership to our organization.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, we got to get a photo up.
Watch out.
All right. Good.
Got my thin right side?
And I have a question.
Mo, this question.
Where does the name Lions Gate come from?
Israel. There's a Lions Gate in Israel, and as I wasn't here when they decided, but I understood that they put 30 Jews in a room and got 95 names. and they came up with Lionsgate.
Winning amount is $43. We collected 86. Half is 43.
My goodness, I wouldn't believe that.
Okay, I said no. Hey, you want to say something first? I'll let you do that before I read the
quick question.
Thank you. Quick question. I have a potential speaker who can come sometime in the next few months who will talk about Social Security and Medicare. I hate to ask this group, but how many of you are not on Social Security or Medicare who might be interested in this topic? All right. Thank you very much.
Now, because the health care is, as Mo said, going up to 125,000, we might have to look at our 50-50 and increase it. Winning number 744-462.
I the first three.
744-462.
Oh, it's fixed.
Oh, fixed.
Well, the other time I gave it back.
Okay, you want to get a...
Wait, didn't you win the last time?
Yeah, but I gave it back.
It's legit. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, I believe that's it. Any other comments from any of the members? Again, Mo, thank you for hosting us. Barry, you have something?
I forgot about